This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The history of Postal Service of the United States began with the delivery of stampless letters, whose cost was borne by the receiving person, later also encompassed pre-paid letters carried by private mail carriers and provisional post offices, and culminated in a system of universal pre-payment that required all letters to bear nationally issued adhesive postage stamps in the earliest days. Ship captains arriving in port with stampless mail would advertise in the local newspaper names of those having mail and for them to come collect and pay for it. If not already paid for by the sender, postal delivery in the United States was a matter of haphazard local organization until after the Revolutionary War, when eventually a national postal system was established. Stampless letters, paid for by the receiver, and private postal systems, were gradually phased out after the introduction of adhesive postage stamps, first issued by the U.S. Government Post Office July 1, 1847, in the denominations of 5 and 10 cents, with the use of stamps made mandatory in 1855. The issue and use of adhesive postage stamps continued during the 19th century, primarily for first-class mail. Each of these stamps generally bore the face or bust of an American president or another historically important statesman. However, once the post office realized during the 1890s that it could increase revenues by selling stamps as collectibles, it began issuing commemorative stamps, first in connection with important national expositions, later for the anniversaries of significant American historical events. Continued technological innovation subsequently prompted the introduction of special stamps, such as those for use with airmail, Zeppelin mail, registered mail, certified mail, and so on. Postage due stamps were issued for some time and were pasted by the post office to letters having insufficient postage, with the postage due to be paid to the postal carrier at the receiving address. Today, stamps issued by the post office are self-adhesive, and no longer require that the stamps be licked to dissolve the glue on their back. In many cases, post office clerks now use postal value indicators, PVI, which are computer labels, instead of stamps, where for a century and a half or so, stamps were almost invariably denominated with their values 5 cent, 10 cent, etc. The United States Post Office now sells non-denominated forever stamps for use on first-class and international mail. These stamps are still valid even if there is a rate increase. However, for other uses, adhesive stamps with denomination indicators are still available and sold. Contents 1. Early postal history. 2. Post offices and postmarks. 3. Mail before postage stamps. 4. Provisional issue stamps. 5. First national postage stamps. 6. Issues of the Civil War era. 61. Pony Express. 62. Encased postage stamps. 7. Grills. 8. 1869. 9. Bank notes. 91. Special delivery. 10. Columbian issue. 11. Bureau issues. 12. Start of the 20th century. 13. Definitive issues of 1902, 1903, 14. Commemorative issues. 1904, 1907, 15. Washington Franklin era. 16. The 1920s and 1930s. 161. 2 cent red sesquicentennial issues of 1926, 1932, 162 Graf Zeppelin stamps. 163. The New Deal era. 164. Presidential issue of 1938. 17. Famous American series of 1940. 18. World War II. 19. Post-World War II. 20. Air mail. 21. Abraham Lincoln postage issues. 22. Modern U.S. stamps. 221. New stamps. 23. Timeline. 24. See also. 25. References and sources. 26. Further reading. 27. External links. Early postal history. Postal services began in the first half of the 17th century, serving the first American colonies. Today, the United States Postal Service is a large government organization providing a wide range of services across the U.S. and its territories abroad. B. Free Franklin Post Office in Philadelphia in the American colonies. Informal independently run postal routes began in Boston as early as 1639, with Boston to New York City service starting in 1672. Officially sanctioned mail service began in 1692 when King William III granted to an English nobleman a delivery patent that included the exclusive right to establish and collect a formal postal tax on official documents of all kinds. Years later, taxation implemented through the mandatory mandatory purchase of stamps was an issue that helped to spark the American Revolution. The tax was repealed a year later, and very few were ever actually used in the 13 colonies, but they saw service in Canada and the British Caribbean islands in the years leading up to the American Revolution. Mail routes among the colonies existed along the few roads between Boston, New York, and Philadelphia in the middle 18th century. Individuals like Benjamin Franklin and William Goddard were the colonial postmasters who managed the mails then and were the general architects of a postal system that started out as an alternative to the Crown Post, the colonial mail system then, which was now becoming more distrusted as the American Revolution drew near. The postal system that Franklin and Goddard forged out of the American Revolution became the standard for the new U.S. Post Office and is a system whose basic designs are still used in the United States Postal Service today. Post offices and postmarks. Play Media Visualizing U.S. Expansion Through Post Offices, 1700-1900. In 1775, when Benjamin Franklin was appointed the first Postmaster General, the U.S. Post Office was born. So important was the Postmaster General that in 1829 this position was included among those in the President's Cabinet. As America began to grow and new towns and villages began to appear, so too did the Post Office, along with them the dates and postmarks generated from these places. Often has provided the historian with a window into a given time and place in question. Each postmark is uniquely distinctive with its own name of state and town. In addition to its distinctive date, post offices that existed along railroad lines and at various military posts have their own special historical aspect. Mail and postmarks generated from prisoner of war camps during the Civil War, or from aboard naval ships, each with a U.S. post office aboard, can and have offered amazing insights into United States history and are avidly sought after by historians and collectors alike. Multiple dates: in 1861 August 29, 1893 October 17, 1898 December 25, 1932 Ellisville Post Office, Illinois, 1891. Mail before postage stamps: an 1832 stampless single sheet Liverpool ship letter, pen franked, paid 5 by a U.S. postal clerk in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Before the introduction of stamps, it was the recipient of mail, not the sender, who generally paid the cost of postage, giving the fee directly to the postman on delivery. The task of collecting money for letter after letter greatly slowed the postman on his route. Moreover, the addressee would not infrequently refuse a piece of mail, which then had to be taken back to the post office. Post office budgets always allowed for an appreciable volume of unpaid for mail. Only occasionally did a sender pay delivery costs in advance, an arrangement that usually required a personal visit to the post office to be sure. Postmasters allowed some citizens to run charge accounts for their delivered and prepaid mail, but bookkeeping on these constituted another inefficiency. Postage stamps revolutionized this process, leading to universal prepayment, but a precondition for their issue by a nation was the establishment of standardized rates for delivery throughout the country. If postal fees were to remain as they were in many lands, a patchwork of many different jurisdictional rates, the use of stamps would produce only limited gains in efficiency, for postal clerks would still have to spend time calculating the rates on many letters. Only then would senders know how much postage to put on them. Provisional issue stamps: New York Postmaster's Provisional, 1845 Provisional stamp from Providence, Rhode Island. The introduction of postage stamps in the UK in May 1840 was received with great interest in the United States and around the world. Later that year, Daniel Webster rose in the U.S. Senate to recommend that the recent English postal reforms, standardized rates, and the use of postage stamps be adopted in America. It would be private enterprise, however, that brought stamps to the U.S. On February 1, 1842, a new carrier service called City Dispatch Post began operations in New York City, introducing the first adhesive postage stamp ever produced in the Western Hemisphere, which it required its clients to use for all mail. This stamp was a three-issue bearing a rather amateurish drawing of George Washington, printed from line-engraved plates in sheets of 42 images. The company had been founded by Henry Thomas Windsor, a London merchant who at the time was living in Hoboken, New Jersey. Alexander M. Gregg was advertised as the Post's agent, and as a result, historians and philatelists have tended to refer to the firm simply as Gregg's City Dispatch Post, making no mention of Windsor. In another innovation, the company placed mail collection boxes around the city for the convenience of its customers. A few months after its founding, the City Dispatch Post was sold to the U.S. government, which renamed it the United States City Dispatch Post. The government began operation of this local post on August 16, 1842, under an act of Congress of some years earlier that authorized local delivery. Gregg, retained by the post office to run the service, kept the firm's original Washington stamp in use, but soon had its lettering altered to reflect the name change in its revised form. This issue accordingly became the first postage stamp produced under the auspices of a government in the Western Hemisphere. An act of Congress of March 3, 1845, effective July 1, 1845, established uniform and mostly reduced postal rates throughout the nation, with a uniform rate of 5 cents for distances under 300 miles. 500 issues are rare, some inordinately so. At a Siegel Gallery auction in New York on March 2012, an example of the Millbury Provisional fetched $400,000, while copies of the Alexandria and Annapolis Provisionals each sold for $550,000. 11 cities printed provisional stamps in 1845 and 1846. Provisional stamp issued in St. Louis, Missouri. Alexandria, Virginia. Alexandria Post Office. In Circle, Annapolis, Maryland. Eagle in Circle, Baltimore, Maryland. James Buchanan Signature. Boscawen, New Hampshire. Paid, 5 cents. Brattleboro, Vermont. Shaded box with postmaster initials inside. Lockport, New York. Lockport, NY. In Oval, Millbury, Massachusetts. Woodcut of George Washington. New Haven, Connecticut. Post office. In box, PM Signature. New York, New York. Post office. Over Washington. Portrait. Providence, Rhode Island. Post office. Prov. Re. In shaded box. St. Louis, Missouri. St. Louis Bears, Missouri. Coat of arms. See also, a gallery of U.S. Postmasters. Provisional stamps, 1845-47. The 1845 Congressional Act did, in fact, raise the rate on one significant class of mail. The so-called drop letter, i.e., a letter delivered from the same post office that collected it previously 1 cent, the drop letter rate became 2 cents. First national postage stamps. Benjamin Franklin and George Washington. The first U.S. postage stamps issued 1847. The first stamp issues were authorized by an act of Congress and approved on March 3, 1847. The earliest known use of the Franklin 5 is July 7, 1847, while the earliest known use of the Washington 10 is July 2, 1847, remaining in postal circulation for only a few years. These issues were declared invalid for postage on July 1, 1851. Congress finally provided for the issuance of stamps by passing an act on March 3, 1847, and the Postmaster General immediately let a contract to the New York City engraving firm of Rodden, Wright, Hatch, and Edson. The first stamp issue of the U.S. was offered for sale on July 1, 1847, in New York City, with Boston receiving stamps the following day and other cities thereafter. They consisted of an engraved 5-cent red-brown stamp depicting Benjamin Franklin, the first postmaster of the U.S., and a 10-cent value in black with George Washington. Like all U.S. stamps until 1857, they were imperforate. The 5-cent stamp paid for a letter weighing less than 1/2 ounce and traveling up to 300 miles, the 10-cent stamp for deliveries to locations greater than 300 miles, or, twice the weight deliverable for the 5-cent stamp. Each stamp was hand-engraved in what is believed to be steel, and laid out in sheets of 200 stamps. The 5-cent stamp is often found today with very poor impressions because the type of ink used contained small pieces of quartz that wore down the steel plates used to print the stamp. On the other hand, most 10-cent stamps are of strong impressions. A fresh and brilliantly printed 5-cent stamp is prized by collectors. The use of stamps was optional. Letters could still be sent requiring payment of postage on delivery. Indeed, the post office issued number 2-cent value for prepaying drop letters in 1847, and these continued to be handled as they had been nevertheless. Many Americans took up using stamps, about 3,700,000 of the 5 and about 865,000 of the 10 were sold, and enough of those have survived to ensure a ready supply for collectors, although the demand is such that a very fine 5 sells for around $500 as of 2003, and the 10 in very fine condition sells for around $1,400 in used form. Unused stamps are much scarcer, fetching around $6,000 and $28,000 respectively. If in very fine condition, one can pay as little as 5-10% of these figures. If the stamps are in poor condition, the post office had become so efficient by 1851 that Congress was able to reduce the common rate to 3 cents, which remained unchanged for over 30 years, necessitating a new issue of stamps. Moreover, the common rate now applied to letters carried up to 3,000 miles. This rate However, only applied to prepaid mail, a letter sent without a stamp still cost the recipient 5 cents, clear evidence that Congress envisioned making stamp use mandatory in the future. It did so in 1855. The 1 cent drop letter rate was also restored, and post office plans did not at first include a stamp for it. Later, however, an essay for a 6 cent Franklin double weight stamp was converted into a drop letter value along with this one stamp. The post office initially issued only two additional denominations in the series of 1851 to 3 and 12, the three stamps going on sale that July and August. Since the 1847 stamps no longer conformed to any postal rate, they were declared invalid after short period during which the public could exchange old stamps for new ones. Ironically, however, within a few years the post office found that stamps in the old denominations were needed after all, and so, added a 10 value to the series in 1855, followed by a 5 stamp the following year. The full series included a 1 profile of Franklin in blue, a 3 profile of Washington in red-brown, a 5 portrait of Thomas Jefferson, and portraits of Washington for 10 green and 12 black values. The one stamp achieved notoriety, at least among philatelists, because production problems. The stamp design was too tall for the space provided, led to a welter of plate modifications done in piecemeal fashion, and there are no fewer than 7 major varieties, ranging in price from $100 to $200,000, the latter for the only stamp of the 200 images on the first plate that displays the design's top and bottom ornamentation complete. Sharp-eyed collectors periodically find the rare types going unrecognized. First National Postage Stamps. Benjamin Franklin issue of 1851, George Washington issue of 1855, Thomas Jefferson issue of 1857, George Washington issue of 1857, George Washington issue of 1857 saw the introduction of perforation, and in 1860 24, 30 and 90 values with still more images of Washington and Franklin were issued for the first time. These higher denominations, especially the 90 C value, were available for such a short time, a little over a year, that they had virtually no chance of being used. The 90C stamp used as a very rare item, and so frequently forged that authorities counsel collectors to shun cancelled copies that lack expert certification. In February 1861, a congressional act directed that cards, blank or printed, shall also be deemed mailable matter, and charged with postage at the rate of 1 cent an ounce. Private companies soon began issuing postcards, printed with a rectangle in the top right corner where the stamp was to be affixed. The post office would not produce pre-stamped postal cards for another dozen years. The issue was declared invalid for postage in May 1861, as the Confederate States had supplies of them. Therefore, stamps used after that date usually have the marking "old stamps, not recognized" on the cover. Issues of the Civil War era. Benjamin Franklin issue of 1861, Thomas Jefferson issue of 1861, the Blackjack issue of 1863. The outbreak of the American Civil War threw the postal system into turmoil on April 13, 1861, the day after the firing on Fort Sumter. John H. Reagan, Postmaster General of the Confederate States of America, ordered local postmasters to return their U.S. stamps to Washington, D.C., although it is unlikely that many did so. While in May the Union decided to withdraw and invalidate all existing U.S. stamps, and to issue new stamps, Confederate post offices were left without legitimate stamps for several months, and while many reverted to the old system of cash payment at the post office, over 100 post offices across the South came up with their own provisional issues. Many of these are quite rare, with only single examples surviving of some types. Eventually the Confederate government issued its own stamps. See Stamps and Postal History of the Confederate States in the North. The new stamp designs became available in August, and old stamps were accepted in exchange, with different deadlines for replacement set for different regions of the country, first ranging from September 10 to November 1, later modified to November 1 to January 1, 1862. The whole process was very confusing to the public, and there are a number of covers from 1862 and later with 1857 stamps and bearing the marking "old stamps not recognized." The 1861 stamps had in common the letters U.S. in their design to make them differentiable from the older stamps at a glance. All were required to have their values expressed in Arabic numerals. In the previous series, Arabic numerals had appeared only on the 30 stamp. The original issue included all the denominations offered in the previous series, 1, 3, 5, 10, 12, 24, 30 and 90 stamps numerals apart. Several of these are superficially similar to their earlier counterparts, particularly because Franklin, Washington and Jefferson still appear on the same denominations as previously. Differences in the design of the frames are more readily apparent. A 2-stamp in black featuring Andrew Jackson was issued in 1863 and is now known to collectors as the Black Jack. A black 15-stamp depicting the recently assassinated Abraham Lincoln was issued in 1866, and is generally considered part of the same series, although it was not officially described as such, and the 15 value was chosen to cover newly established fee for registered letters. Many philatelists consider this to be the first memorial stamp ever issued. The war greatly increased the amount of mail in the North. Ultimately, about 1,750,000,000 copies of the 3-stamp were printed, and a great many have survived to the present day, typically selling for $2 to $3 a piece. Most are rose-colored. Pink versions are much rarer and quite expensive, especially the Pigeon Blood Pink, which goes for $3,000 and up. The stamps of the 1861 series, unlike those of the two previous issues, remained valid for postage after they had been superseded, as has every subsequent United States stamp. Pony Express. Pony Express compound oval postmark, one of many types found on the covers of Pony Express mail. Main article, Pony Express. In 1860, the U.S. Post Office incorporated the services of the Pony Express to get mail to and from San Francisco, an important undertaking with the outbreak of the Civil War, as a communication link between Union forces and San Francisco and the West Coast was badly needed. The Pony Express trail from St. Joseph, Missouri, to Sacramento, California, was 1,840 miles long upon arrival in Sacramento. The U.S. mail was placed on a steamer and continued down the Sacramento River to San Francisco for a total of 1,966 miles. The Pony Express was a short-lived enterprise, remaining in operation for only 18 months. Consequently, there is little surviving Pony Express mail today, only 250 examples known in existence. Encased postage stamps. Widespread hoarding of coins during the Civil War created a shortage, prompting the use of stamps for currency. To be sure, the fragility of stamps made them unsuitable for hand-to-hand circulation, and to solve this problem, John Galt invented the encased postage stamp in 1862. A normal U.S. stamp was wrapped around a circular cardboard disc and then placed inside a coin-like circular brass jacket. A transparent mica window in the jacket allowed the face of the stamp to be seen. All 8 denominations available in 1861-62, ranging from 1 cent to 90 cents, were offered in encased versions. Raised lettering on the metal backs of the jackets often advertised the goods or services of business firms. These included the Aerated Bread Company, Ayers Sarsaparilla and Cathartic Pills, Burnett's Cocoen, Sands Ale, Drake's Plantation. Bitters, Boule. 11 types of grill in use, distinguished by size and shape. Philatelists have labeled them with letters A, J, and Z, and that the practice started sometime in 1867 and was gradually abandoned after 1871. A number of grilled stamps are among the great rarities of U.S. philately. The United States 1Z grill was long thought to be the rarest of all U.S. stamps, with only 2 known to exist in 1961. However, it was discovered that the 15 stamp of the same series also existed in a Z grill version. This stamp is just as rare as the one, for only 2 examples of the 15Z grill are known. Rarer still may be the 30 stamp with the I grill, the existence of which was discovered only recently. As of October 2011, only 1 copy is known. 1869 Main article, 1869 Pictorial issue. Declaration of Independence horse. Other innovations in what has become known as the 1869 pictorial issue included the first use of 2-color printing on U.S. stamps, and as a consequence the first invert errors. Although popular with collectors today, the unconventional stamps were not very popular among a population who was accustomed to postage that bore classic portrayals of Washington, Franklin, and other forefathers. Consequently, the post office recalled all remaining stocks after 1 year. Bank notes. Washington American Bank Note 1883 issue. Oliver Hazard Perry National Bank Note 1870 issue. The postage stamps issued in the 1870s and 1880s are collectively known as the bank notes because they were produced by the National Bank Note Company, the Continental Bank Note Company, then the American Bank Note Company. After the 1869 fiasco with pictorial stamp issues, the new Postmaster General decided to base a series of stamps on the heads, in profile, of distinguished deceased Americans, using marble busts of acknowledged excellence as models. George Washington was returned to the normal letter rate stamp. He had played that role in the issues of 1851 and 1861 and would continue to do so in every subsequent definitive set until the presidential series of 1938, but the large banknotes did not represent a total retreat to past practices, for the range of celebrated Americans was widened beyond Franklin and various presidents to include notables such as Henry Clay and Oliver Hazard Perry. Moreover, while images of statesmen had provided the only pictorial content of pre-1869 issues, the large banknotes did not entirely exclude other representative images. Two denominations of the series accompanied their portraits with iconographic images appropriate to the statesmen they honored. Rifles, a cannon and cannonballs appeared in the bottom corners of the 24-cent issue devoted to General Winfield Scott, while the 90-cent stamp framed Admiral Oliver Perry within a nautically hitched oval of rope and included anchors in the bottom corners of its design. National first printed these, then in 1873 Continental received the contract, and the plates that National used Continental added secret marks to the plates of the lower values, distinguishing them from the previous issues. The American Bank Note Company acquired Continental in 1879 and took over the contract, printing similar designs on softer papers and with some color changes. Major redesigning, however, came only in 1890, when the American Bank Note Company issued a new series in which stamp size was reduced by about 10%, the so-called small bank notes. In 1873, the post office began producing a pre-stamped postcard. One side was printed with a Liberty Head 1-cent stamp design, along with the words United States Postal Card and three blank lines provided for the mailing address. 6 years later, it introduced a series of seven postage due stamps in denominations ranging from 1 to 50, all printed in the same brownish-red color and conforming to the same uniform and highly utilitarian design, with their denominations rendered in numerals much larger than those found on definitive stamps. The design remained unchanged until 1894, and only four different postage due designs have appeared to date. In 1883, the first class letter rate was reduced from 3 to 2, prompting a redesign of the existing 3 green Washington stamp, which now became a 2 brown issue special delivery first special delivery stamp, 1885. In 1885, the post office established a special delivery service, issuing a 10-cent stamp depicting a running messenger, along with the wording secures immediate delivery at a special delivery office. Initially, only 555 such offices existed, but the following year all U.S. post offices were obliged to provide the service, an extension not, however, reflected on the special delivery stamp until 1888, when the words at any post office appeared on its reprint on stamps of future years. The messenger would be provided the technological enhancements of a bicycle, a motorcycle and a truck, although the last new U.S. special delivery stamp appeared issued in 1971. The service was continued until 1997, by which time it had largely been supplanted by priority mail delivery. Introduced in 1989, the 1885 special delivery issue was the first U.S. postage stamp designed in the double-width format. 8 years later, this shape would be chosen for the Columbian Exposition commemoratives, as it offered appropriate space for historical tableaus. The double-width layout would subsequently be employed in many United States commemoratives. Columbia issue landing of Christopher Columbus issue of 1893. Main article, Columbian issue. The World Columbian Exposition of 1893 commemorated the 400th anniversary of the landing of Christopher Columbus in the Americas. The post office got in on the act, issuing a series of 16 stamps depicting Columbus and episodes in his career, ranging in value from $1 to $5, a princely sum in those days. They are often considered the first commemorative stamps issued by any country. The stamps were interesting and attractive, designed to appeal to not only postage stamps collectors but to historians, artists and of course the general public, who bought them in record numbers because of the fanfare of the Columbian Exposition of the World's Fair of 1892. In Chicago, Illinois, they were quite successful, a great contrast to the pictorials of 1869, with lines spilling out of the nation's post offices to buy the stamps there, prized by collectors today with the $5 denomination, for example, selling for between $1,500 to $12,500 or more, depending upon the condition of the stamp being sold. Another release in connection with the Columbian series was a reprint of the 1888 special delivery stamp, now colored orange reportedly, to prevent prevent postal clerks from confusing it with the One Colombian after sales of the series ceased. The special delivery stamp reappeared in its original Blue Bureau issue's original 1890 George Washington issue without the corner triangles. Washington 2-cent Bureau issue clearly showing the triangles in the upper corners also during 1893. The Bureau of Engraving and Printing competed for the postage stamp printing contract, and won it on the first try for the postage issues of the 1894 series. The Bureau took over the plates of the 1890 small banknote series but modified them by adding triangles to the upper corners of the designs. Three new designs were needed, because the post office elected to add $1, $2 and $5 stamps to the series previously. The top value of any definitive issue had been 90 on many of the 1894 stamps. Perforations are of notably poor quality, but the Bureau would soon make technical improvements. In 1895, counterfeits of the two value were discovered, which prompted the BEP to begin printing stamps on watermarked paper for the first time in U.S. postal history. The watermarks embedded the logo USPS into the paper in double-lined letters. The Bureau's definitive issues of the 1890s consisted of 13 different denominations ranging from 1 cent to $5, and may be differentiated by the presence or absence of this watermark, which would appear on all U.S. postage stamps between 1895 and 1910. The final issue of 1898 altered the colors of many denominations to bring the series into conformity with the recommendations of the Universal Postal Union, an international body charged with facilitating the course of transnational mail. The aim was to ensure that in all its member nations, stamps for given classes of mail would appear in the same colors accordingly. U.S. 1 stamps postcards were now green, and 5 stamps international mail were now blue, while 2 stamps remained red. As a result, it was also necessary to replace the blue and green on higher values with other colors. U.S. postage continued to reflect this color coding quite strictly until the mid-1930s, continuing also in the invariable use of purple for 3 stamps. Start of the 20th century. Trans-Mississippi issue, 1898-1. See, in 1898, the Trans-Mississippi Exposition opened in Omaha, Nebraska, and the post office was ready with the Trans-Mississippi issue. The 9 stamps were originally to be two-toned, with black vignettes surrounded by colored frames, but the BEP, its resources overtaxed by the needs of the Spanish-American War, simplified the printing process, issuing the stamps in single colors. They were received favorably, though with less excitement than the Colombians, but like the Colombians, they are today prized by collectors, and many consider the $1 Western Cattle in Storm the most attractive of all U.S. stamps. Pan-American issue, 1901-2. Two C collectors, still smarting from the expense of the Colombian stamps, objected that inclusion of $1 and $2 issues in the Trans-Mississippi series presented them with an undue financial hardship. Accordingly, the next stamp series commemorating a prominent exposition, the Pan-American Exposition held in Buffalo, New York in 1901, was considerably less costly, consisting of only 6 stamps ranging from in value 1 to 10. The result, paradoxically, was a substantial increase in post office profits, for while the higher-valued Colombians and Trans-Mississippis had sold only about 20,000 copies apiece, the public bought well over 5 million of every Pan-American denomination in the Pan-American series. The post office realized the plan for two-tone stamps that it had been obliged to abandon during the production of the Trans-Mississippi issue. Upside-down placement of some sheets during the two-stage printing process resulted in the so-called Pan-American invert errors on rare copies. Of the 1, 2 and 4 stamps definitive issues of 1902-1903 main article, series of 1902. The definitive stamps issued by the U.S. Post Office in 1902-1903 were markedly different in their overall designs from the regular definitive stamps released over the previous several decades. Among the prominent departures from tradition in these designs was that the names of the subjects were printed out, along with their years of birth and death. Printed names and birth and death dates are more typically a feature of commemorative stamps, unlike any definitive stamps ever issued before. The 1902-03 issues also had ornate sculptural framework redolent of Beaux-Arts architecture about the portrait, often including allegorical figures of different sorts, with several different types of print used to denote the country, denominations and names of the subjects. This series of postage stamps were the first definitive issues to be entirely designed and printed by the Bureau of Engraving and Printing, and their Baroque Revival style is much akin to that of the Pan-American American commemoratives the Bureau had issued in 1901, there are 14 denominations ranging from 1 cent to $5. The 2 cent George Washington stamp appeared with two different designs. The original version was poorly received, while each of the other values has its own individual design. This was the first U.S. definitive series to include the image of a woman, Martha Washington, who appeared on the 8-cent stamp. Selected issues: Franklin Lincoln Harrison Marshall commemorative issues, 1904-1907. In these years, the Postal Service continued to produce commemorative sets in conjunction with important national expositions. The Louisiana Purchase Exposition in St. Louis, Missouri in 1904 prompted a set of 5 stamps, while a trio of stamps commemorated the Jamestown Exposition, held in Norfolk, Virginia in 1907. Washington Franklin era main article. Washington Franklin issues 1908 saw the beginning of the long-running Washington-Franklin series of stamps. Although there were only 2 central images, a profile of Washington and one of Franklin, many subtle variants appeared over the years, for the post office experimented with half a dozen different perforation sizes, 2 kinds of watermarking, 3 printing methods, and large numbers of values, all adding to several hundred distinct types identified by collectors. Some are quite rare, but many are extremely common. This was the era of the postcard craze, and almost every antique shop in the U.S. will have some postcards with green 1 or red 2 stamps from this series. In 1910, the post office began phasing out the double-lined watermark, replacing it by the same USPS logo in smaller single-line letters. Watermarks were discontinued entirely in 1916. Commemoratives were issued until after World War I. The Lincoln Centennial's portrait format distinguished it from all other commemoratives released between 1893 and 1926, which were produced exclusively in landscape format. The next U.S. commemorative in portrait orientation would be the Vermont Sesquicentennial issue of 1927, and many have appeared since. 20 parcel post stamp issued in 1912. This was the first time in history an airplane appeared on a postage stamp. It was also in 1913. In January, that the post office introduced domestic parcel post service, a belated development, given that international parcel post service between the United States and other countries began in 1887. A series of 12 parcel post stamps intended for this service had already been released in December 1912, ranging in denomination from $1 to $1. All were printed in red and designed in the wide Columbian format. The 8 lowest values illustrated aspects of mail handling and delivery, while higher denominations depicted such industries as manufacturing, dairying, and fruit growing. 5 green parcel post postage due stamps appeared concurrently. It soon became obvious that none of these stamps was needed. Parcel postage could easily be paid by definitive or commemorative issues, and normal postage due stamps were sufficient for parcels. When original stocks ran out, no reprints appeared, nor were replacements for either group ever contemplated. However, one denomination introduced in the parcel post series, 20, had proved useful, and the post office added this value to the Washington Franklin issues in 1914, along with a 30 stamp on November 3, 1917. The normal letter rate was raised from 2 to 3 in support of the war effort. The rate hike was reflected in the first post-war commemorative, a 3 victory stamp released on March 3, 1919. Not until July 1 would postal fees return to peacetime levels. Only once before, with the Lincoln Memorial issue of 1909, had the post office issued a commemorative stamp unconnected to an important national exposition, and the appearance of the Pilgrim Tercentenary series in 1920 confirmed that a new policy was developing. The post office would no longer need the pretext of significant patriotic trade fairs to issue commemoratives. They could now freely produce stamps commemorating the anniversaries of any notable historical figures, organizations, or events. The 1920s and 1930s. 1923 Freedom, $5, blue and red. The stamps of the 1920s were dominated by the series of 1922, the first new design of definitive stamps to appear in a generation. The lower values mostly depicted various presidents, with the 5C particularly intended as a memorial of the recently deceased Theodore Roosevelt, while the higher values included an American Indian, hollow horn bear, the Statue of Liberty, Golden Gate without the bridge, which had yet to be built, Niagara Falls, a bison, the Lincoln Memorial, and so forth. Higher values of the series from 17 through $5 were differentiated from the cheaper stamps by being designed in horizontal landscape rather than vertical format, an idea carried over from the Big Bens of the Washington Franklin series regular issues 1922-1925. Stamp printing was switching from a flat plate press to a rotary press while these stamps were in use, and most come in two perforations as a result, 11 for flat plate, and 11 by 105 for rotary in 1929. Theft problems in the Midwest led to the Kansas-Nebraska overprint on the regular stamps. See also, 4th Bureau issue from 1924 on. Commemorative stamps appeared every year. The 1920s saw a number of 150th anniversaries connected with the American Revolutionary War, and a number of stamps were issued in connection with those. These included the first U.S. souvenir sheet, for the Battle of White Plains sesquicentennial, and the first overprint, reading Molly, Pitcher, the heroine of the Battle of Monmouth II, sent red sesquicentennial issues of 1926-1932. 2 cent red sesquicentennial issues of 1926-1932. During this period, the U.S. Post Office issued more than a dozen 2 cent reds commemorating the 150th anniversaries of battles and events that occurred during the American Revolution. The first among these was the Liberty Bell 150th anniversary issue of 1926, designed by Claire Aubrey Houston, and engraved by Heisler. Master engravers. The 2 cent reds were among the last stamps used to carry a letter for 2 cents, the rate changing to 3 cents on July 6, 1932. The rate remained the same for 26 years until it finally changed to 4 cents in 1958. Graf Zeppelin stamps 65 cent Zeppelin of 1930, issued in April for the May to June Pan American flight of the Graf Zeppelin. The German Zeppelins were of much interest during this period, and in 1930 the department issued special stamps to be used on the Pan-American flight of Graf Zeppelin. Although the Graf Zeppelin stamps are today highly prized by collectors as masterpieces of the engraver's art, in 1930 the recent stock market crash meant that few were able to afford these stamps. The $455 value for the set represented a week's food allowance for a family of four. Less than 10% of the 1 million of each denomination issued were sold, and the remainders were incinerated. The stamps were only available for sale to the public from April 19, 1930, to June 30, 1930. It is estimated that less than 8% of the stamps produced survive today, and they remain the smallest U.S. issue of the 20th century. Only 229,260 of these stamps were ever purchased, and only 61,296 of the $260 stamp were sold in 1932. A set of 12 stamps was issued to celebrate the George Washington's 200th birthday, 1932 Washington Bicentennial, for the 2 value, which satisfied the normal letter rate. The most familiar Gilbert Stuart image of Washington had been chosen after postal rates rose that July. This 2 red Washington was redesigned as a 3 stamp and issued in the purple color that now became ubiquitous among U.S. commemoratives. The New Deal era. In 1933, Franklin D. Roosevelt became president. He was notable not only as an avid collector in his own right with a collection estimated at around 1 million stamps, but also for taking an interest in the stamp issues of the department, working closely with Postmaster James Farley, the former Democratic Party committee chairman. Many designs of the 1930s were inspired or altered according to Roosevelt's advice. In 2009-10, the National Postal Museum exhibited 6 Roosevelt sketches that were developed into stamp issues, the 6-cent Eagle Airmail stamp and 5 miscellaneous commemoratives, which honored the Byrd Antarctic Expedition, the Mothers of America, Susan B. Anthony, Virginia Dare and the Northwest Territories rise to statehood. A steady stream of commemoratives appeared during these years, including a striking 1934 issue of 10 stamps presenting iconic vistas of 10 national parks, a set that has remained widely beloved in a memorable sequence from Philip Roth's novel The Plot Against America. The young protagonist dreams that his national park stamps, the pride and joy of his collection, have become disfigured, with swastika overprints choosing an orange color for the 2 Grand Canyon tableau instead of the standard 2 Carmen red. The post office departed from UPU color coding for the first time. National Parks issue 1936 souvenir sheet reproducing 4 recent 3-cent commemoratives with a philatelist in the White House. The post office catered to collectors as never before, issuing 7 separate souvenir sheets between 1933 and 1937 in one case. A collector's series had to be produced as the result of a miscalculation around 1935. Postmaster Farley removed sheets of the national parks set from stock before they had been gummed or perforated, giving these these and unfinished examples of 10 other issues to President Roosevelt and Interior Secretary Harold Ickes, also a philatelist, as curiosities for their collections. When word of these gifts got out, public outcries arose. Some accused Farley of a corrupt scheme to enrich Roosevelt and Ickes by creating valuable rarities for them at taxpayer expense. Stamp aficionados, in turn, demanded that these curiosities be sold to the public so that ordinary collectors could acquire them, and Farley duly issued them in bulk. This series of special printings soon became known as Farley's Follies. As the decade progressed, the purples used for three issues, although still ostensibly conforming to the traditional purple, displayed an increasingly wide variety of hues, and one 1940 issue, a three-stamp commemorating the Pony Express, dispensed with purple entirely, appearing in a rust-brown earth tone more suitable to the image of a horse and rider departing from a western rural post office. Presidential issue of 1938. Presidential issue of 1938. Main article, presidential issue. The famous presidential issue, known as Prexies for short, came out in 1938. The series featured all 29 U.S. presidents through Calvin Coolidge, each of whom appeared in profile as a small sculptural bust. Values of 50 and lower were mono-colored. On the $1, $2, and $5 stamps, the president's images were printed in black on white, surrounded by colored lettering and ornamentation up through the 22 Cleveland stamp. The denomination assigned to each president corresponds to his position in the presidential roster. Thus, the first president, Washington, is on the 1 value, the 17th, Andrew Johnson, is on the 17 value, etc. Additional stamps depict Franklin, Martha Washington 1.5, and the White House 4.5. Many of the values were included merely to place the presidents in proper numerical order and did not necessarily correspond to a postal rate, and one of the difficult games for Prexy collectors is to find a cover with, for instance, a single 16 stamp that pays a combination of rate and fees valid during the Prexy's period of usage. Many such covers remain to be discovered. Some sellers on eBay have been surprised to discover an ordinary seeming cover bid up to several hundred dollars because it was one of the sought after solo usages. The presidential issue remained in distribution for many years. Not until 1954 did the post office begin replacing its values with the stamps of a new definitive issue, the Liberty Series. Famous American Series of 1940. In 1940, the U.S. Post Office issued a set of 35 stamps, issued over the course of approximately 10 months, commemorating America's famous authors, poets, educators, scientists, composers, artists, and inventors. The educators included Booker T. Washington, who now became the first African American to be honored on a U.S. stamp. This series of postage issues was printed by the Bureau of Engraving and Printing. These stamps were larger in size than normal definitive issues, with only 280 stamp images contained on the printing plate. 400 images was standard for the presidential series. Notable also is the red-violet color chosen for the three stamps, a brighter hue than the traditional purple. Famous American Series of 1940 resolution, 4,401 × 5,985. Authors, Washington Irving, James Fenimore Cooper, Ralph Waldo Emerson, Louisa May Alcott, Samuel Clemens. Poets, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, John Greenleaf Whittier, James Russell Lowell, Walt Whitman, James Whitcomb Riley. Educators, Horace Mann, Mark Hopkins, Charles W. Eliot, Francis E. Willard, Booker T. Washington. Scientists, John James Audubon, Dr. Crawford W. Long, Luther Burbank, Dr. Walter Reed, Jane Addams. Composers, Stephen Collins Foster, John Philip Sousa, Victor Herbert, Edward A. McDowell, Ethelbert Nevin. Artists, Gilbert Charles Stewart, James McNeil. Whistler, Augustus St. Gaudens, Daniel Chester French, Frederick Remington. Inventors, Eli Whitney, Samuel F. B. Morse, Cyrus Hall McCormick, Elias Howe, Alexander Graham Bell. World War II. Scott Number 905. During World War II, production of new U.S. 3 commemorative stamps all but ceased. Among the three issues that appeared in 1942 was the celebrated Win the War stamp, which enjoyed enormously wide use, owing partly to patriotism and partly to the relative unavailability of alternatives. It presents an eagle posed in a V shape for victory, surrounded by 13 stars. The eagle is grasping arrows, but has no olive branch. A notable commemorative set did, indeed, appear in 1943-44, but its stamps, all valued at 5 cents, were not competitive with the Win the War issue. This was the Overrun Countries series, known to collectors as the Flag Set, produced as a tribute to the 13 nations that had been occupied by